My first movie experience was a movie I was in, believe it or not. So when I was a kid growing up in Chicago, my siblings and I did a little bit of acting. And this was like in fourth or fifth grade when I started. And it was really fun. And we weren't really very serious about it. But it was a great way to miss a day or two of school. And I did a commercial with Walter Payton, which was really fun, and lots of stuff like that. So that was, and that was sort of what we were doing when I was young. And I got cast in a film. So when I was in fifth grade, I was in a made-for-TV movie. It aired on public television. It was a small movie. I hope they're not coming here, are they?
Depends how good the story is.
There's a siren outside, but I'm sure it's fine. And that was a wonderful experience for a young person who ended up falling in love with movies. I mean, looking back on it, it was probably a small film with a small crew, but I didn't know that. I mean, I saw lights and cameras and a wonderful director and a great story. I was the star of this movie. And, you know, it took about 10 days for us to film it, and it's really good. I mean, it's a movie that has been around for a long time. So that was really sort
What's its title?
The title of it was Soft as the Heart of a Child. It was a movie about alcoholism and how it affects children. And I was the child. I was the oldest child in the film. And it was a wonderful experience. And then a few years later, I was actually in another film where I played Tom Sawyer, and Anthony Michael Hall played Huck Finn, and Cynthia Nixon played the Becky Thatcher character. And again, I was so lucky to be able to be around filmmaking at a young age. And I realized when I was a kid that there are real people who do this for a living. This is not like working in the film business or becoming a filmmaker. It's not like trying to buy a winning lottery ticket. It's a real business, it's a real industry. There's wonderful people who work in it. And early on, I just knew that that was what I wanted to do.
So how did you make the leap from kid actor to director?
I hung up my acting cleats. Do you wear cleats? I hung that up really when I got to high school. I kind of knew at a young age that as fun as it is to play Tom Sawyer in a movie, I also saw that acting is challenging. It's really hard. And I also happened to notice that this kid Anthony Michael Hall and this other kid Cynthia Nixon were really actors, and I just sort of got lucky and was cast in this part and sort of acted, just sort of played myself really more than anything. And so I did not this that was not something I really wanted to pursue as an adult. But when I got out of college, I got a job at public television in Chicago and started making documentaries. I always loved documentaries as a kid, as a young person. I was exposed to filmmaking at an early age, so that just seemed like a natural fit, and I've been doing it like 25 years now.
So did you make a move out of Chicago public television?
I was in Chicago for 3 years working at public television in Chicago, and it was a television show called The 90s, which was a really great documentary show back then. And I came out to Los Angeles to go to film school. And I studied at the American Film Institute and got a master's degree in cinematography, which was really fantastic because I came out of graduate school with real skills. Let me just explain. Directing is a real skill, and I think and screenwriting is a real skill. But I think that as a 20-something-year-old kid coming out of grad school, personally, I found that I was more hireable because I knew how to light, I knew how to shoot. I could get a job as an electrician, which I did for Roger Corman. I could get jobs. I just stayed busy and was paying my bills and working. And I think I did see friends of mine and friends of mine from film school who studied directing, studied screenwriting, didn't, those jobs are harder to get when you're mm-hmm. a kid. I don't know how else to say it. I mean, and I hope I'm not discouraging anyone, but I found that coming out of film school, the camera folks and the editing folks went right to work.
Mm-hmm.
There's lots of work in those two departments of the television and film business. And so that really helped me. I was shooting lighting and then eventually shooting like right away, very early
on.
So
when did you decide you were gonna take the leap?
You know, I'm from Chicago and Hoop Dreams was a really big influence on me. And I would say that Roger and Me was a very big influence.
Mm-hmm.
Somehow I had stumbled across the work of the Maisels brothers and D.A. Pennybaker like when I was in high school. I don't know how I did that. I just found them and liked them.
Mm-hmm. They're probably running Grey Gardens on
yeah,
NET or something.
Just I remember just like renting videos back in the 80s of yeah. these like Academy. You know, I rented, I saw the Academy Award logo on a movie called The Times of Harvey Milk. Mm-hmm. Popped it in. I had no idea even what that was. I was totally blown away by that movie. I've since gotten to know Rob very, very well.
Mm-hmm.
Rob Epstein, who directed that film. It's funny because I've met a lot of my heroes because we've started making our own movies and we've met them either at Sundance mm-hmm. or at film festivals. And so I've actually gotten to know some people like Rob Epstein and Barbara Koppel and Mary Lampson, the editor of one of the editors of Harlan County, USA, Kate Amend, another amazing editor, lots of people whose mm-hmm. documentary work I really watched when I was growing up and getting started. I've gotten to know the guys from Hoop Dreams very well, so it's been really fun. I mean, making a documentary film just seemed like a great mountain to climb. I don't know really know how else to say that. And so my wife, Christine, and I, who worked together, just knew that the great leap that we would want to take eventually was to go out and shoot and edit our own film and make our own film. And we had that idea in our head for a couple of years when we finally came across the idea of making what became Wordplay.
Mm-hmm.
She and I were both big crossword puzzle fans. We solve that puzzle a lot. We have three young kids, so we don't do it as much as we used to. But, you know, we were looking for a story that hopefully had a built-in audience. And when we, and what was funny, because I was actually going to buy Christine as a Christmas present, I was going to buy her a Will Shorts documentary. And mm-hmm. I was looking and looking and looking and looking, and I couldn't find it. And I was like, well, come on, there's got to be one. And then I realized there isn't one.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we should do. Because that's interesting to us. And he has a big fan base. He's in the New York Times every day.
Mm-hmm.
He's on NPR every Sunday. That happens to be the crowd that typically would go see a documentary. That seems like a good fit. And so that's how that happened.
So dare I ask whether you were seduced in part by the heat of the moment? I mean, was it Spellbound that was the year before?
Oh, Spellbound.
Sundance?
For sure. Spellbound came out, I want to say 2003 or 4.
Mm-hmm.
And I think Spellbound for us, and I think for a lot of filmmakers, really paved the way for what I would consider, well, two things. More like purely like brainy docs, if mm-hmm. you will, and also competitive documentaries, or
right.
who's gonna win documentaries. I remember the year, a few years after Spellbound, there was Monster Ball? I'm blanking.
That's a feature.
Murder Ball.
Yeah.
There was, I think a film was called Rise about the dancers, mm-hmm. The hip hop dancing.
David LaChapelle did. But I remember your film coming out at Sundance, and I remember, I mean, that year in particular, I remember everybody, all the distributors would rush to the press screenings to see everything as quickly as possible, and then like in most cases, they would all leave within 20 minutes because they figured out, that, okay, this is not the next Spellbound. Or the next.
Yeah.
There was also the dance movie with the kids.
Mad Hat Ballroom was what I was thinking of. That's the third one. There were and still are, I think, these sort of niche pursuits or games or whatever that people play, and a competition built into those. Mm-hmm. And that, in some ways, that's become almost a genre unto itself. I think wordplay, we just never thought of it, at least at first, as a competition movie.
Mm-hmm.
We just thought Will Shorts would be an interesting subject.
Right.
And so he said yes, and we started going down the road with him together. And early on, he said, well, listen, you know, I do this annual tournament where we figure out who's the fastest solver.
Mm.
And immediately I'm like, well, God, okay, that sounds a little bit like Spellbound, and I didn't really want to go there.
Mm.
Just because I was like, well, it didn't strike me as being really what we thought the story was.
Right.
And he's like, well, actually, it's a huge part of who I am, and it's a tournament that I founded, and it really is the biggest thing in the year for me. I love doing the Daily Puzzle in the New York Times. I love being on NPR, but this tournament is my family. Mm-hmm. I'm like, okay, well, all right, we'll come out. We'll do it. You know, we'll do that. And that really became the cornerstone of the film. So, I think it's funny because I think you have to... What I've learned after this is our third film now that we have out, it's called If You Build It. I think more than anything, we've learned whatever your preconceived idea is, maybe that will be a part of what you end up making, but you really ultimately go where the story is. You just jump in and find good characters. Mm. You try to find something that's funny, something that's really poignant. I always look for things that are interesting that people might learn in our stories that they didn't know before. That's actually what I love about documentaries is you can only do so much pre-production. I mean, eventually you have to jump in with your characters and figure out where that's going to go to.
Often before you really have done even pre-production, in a lot of cases.
Yeah, I mean, it's...
A lot of people are shooting before they really know where they're going at all. They kind of... Particularly these days with the cameras that are available.
So we did this movie about the national debt, this movie IOUSA. It was at Sundance in 2008. A couple of the people we interviewed were senators, U.S. senators who are on the Senate Budget Committee. And as part of our production, I had to interview both of those men. So I talked to the press liaison at the U.S. Senate and told him who I was and what I was going to do. And he's like, okay, so you're doing a story about the national debt. So what's your angle? And I was like, well, I don't really have an angle. He's like, well, what do you mean? I was like, well, I'm just doing a story about the national debt. I mean, he's like, so are you a hawk or a dove? I was like, I'm just a guy with a camera. I want to find the story. And I want to find a nonpartisan find out about this subject and then in the process make a story about it.
Mm.
And he's like, no one's ever said that to me. Every person who's ever come in to do a story is either a deficit hawk or a deficit dove, or they're coming from the left or they're coming from the right. And that's not how we do our stuff.
Mm.
We just don't. We try to get as close to who the people are that we're doing a story about.
I thought you were saying the publicist said that that's not how they do their stuff. I was like, wow.
No, I mean...
Until you have some position, get out.
Yeah, no, I mean, we just I don't know. I feel like everyone has their own approach. But for us, we find stories that are interesting to us and then get to know the people who are involved in those stories and help tell their story. That's what we do. We don't really, I don't like that notion of going in with an agenda. I was really lucky when I was just starting out in Chicago, I worked with Studs Terkel quite a bit on a bunch of different shoots, and we shot him a bunch of times. He was a great interviewer. He was a great great journalist, great storyteller, great documentarian. And I remember him saying once, you know, he's like, I try not to editorialize. I try to find good stories and bring those stories out of the people who I'm talking to. And I don't feel that it's my job to spin that. I just go to where the story is and report the story back to my audience. And I think that's, for me, that's the approach we want to do, you know? I mean, I have tons of ideas. I don't want to jam them down someone's face. I mean, not ideas. I have tons of opinions is what I'm saying. I have a tons of opinions about the way that maybe I think the world should work. I'm not going to jam that into our stories, especially something like IOUSA, which is a very political story. If You Build It is a story about education. I would rather let my characters say what they think education should be, and we spend a year in the life of this class that they created in a small town in North Carolina. That's more interesting to me than my own opinions of what I think great schooling should be.
So If You Build It is much, it seems closer to The Maisels in a way than the other two films. Is that fair? Or do you think that you
well, yeah, I mean, that's a really great compliment, but in the sense that, like, we're more a little more fly on the wall-ish, do you mean?
I guess because there's less of a driver. It kind of feels like you picked a subject which involves a lot of people, but you then just recorded it, as opposed to the other two, which, I mean, one is really a biography on some level.
Right.
That has other elements, but is really a biography. And the other does have these political elements, and it's a exploration of that tension.
I think you're absolutely right. I think that our film, If You Build It, Christine and I really knew from the very first day that we started. And we had a wonderful partner on our film called Neil Baer, who's a television show runner and a TV writer. He's also a doctor. He's an MD. And Neil found this story and brought it to us, and we collaborated on it. We knew from day one, this is a story with no famous people in it. There's no sharp point to our story in some ways. And it's really about something pretty broad. It's about education. It's about community development. It's about design thinking. It's about the power of great design. It's about being 16 years old in America, in a town you've never heard of. We knew in a lot of ways that this would be tougher. This is like kind of a, I guess, more challenging of a sell, if you will, to an audience. But we also have three kids at home who are in public schools here in LA. We felt that we personally would learn a lot about education and about what great teachers could do to us, to a room full of kids that they spent a year with. So very selfishly, we just were like, look, this is something we want to do right now, you know, and we did it. The great thing about being an independent documentary filmmaker is if your partner and you want to make a movie, and in this case, we had a third partner, Neil, that's it. We can go. We can start right away. I can grab my camera. I can hop on a plane. I can be in North Carolina a day later. I can start making my movie. There's tremendous independence. We also knew, like, okay, if we get down there, we go down there for a couple of trips. If the story doesn't feel like it's going anywhere, then we don't have to necessarily even do this. Let's see what happens. And literally, like, the first trip there, all hell broke loose, and we were like, this is gonna be great, you know.
So dare I ask, how was funding for you? I mean,
it was hard
after the case, or
funding was hard. We did up a budget. I'm very transparent, so I'm just gonna just let a rip here. We did up a budget for $500,000. We figured, okay, this is gonna be a lot of travel. it's going to take a long time to make it. It'll take about probably 18 months to shoot it and edit it. And, you know, we're going to have a decent sized team to make it. So made a budget. Mm-hmm. Well, 30 months later, the story was still going on. We'd only raised half our funding. It was hard. Like, it was hard. There was about a year there where Christine and I really weren't making any money. We were out of money, but we were still making the movie. Funding had dried up. So, I mean, it was hard. This was like a hard movie to make. And we got through somehow. And then literally at our premiere, we premiered at Full Frame in mm-hmm. North Carolina, which is about 2 hours from where we shot the movie. And at that premiere, one person came forward to close our budget gap,
wow.
which was about $200,000. And another group and a foundation came forward to help us release the film. So that happened in one night. That was our opening night, basically.
So was that just happenstance, or was it? Were you looking for them to be there?
It was. I mean, we did Good Pitch uh-huh. through Sundance. Good Pitch is an event that takes place several times a year around the world. This one was in San Francisco. They've done it in Chicago, New York. They do several internationally, and it's organized. The way they do it is they bring in like 5 to 7 films, and the films and the filmmakers are on center stage, okay? And the audience is broadcasters, foundations, mm-hmm. nonprofits, potential partners for these movies that are in the process of being made. Mm-hmm. And so the Good Pitch really helped us find one of our key partners. And they came forward once the movie was finished. So that was part of it. And then for the release of the film, it was the Candida Fund. It's a small, very low profile fund that's based on the East Coast. But their mission is very much lined up with the story in our film. And that was a surprise to us. We didn't even know they were actually going to be there at the screening. We also got great support from Sundance. We got great support from the MacArthur Foundation, the Wincote Foundation. We had a Kickstarter campaign. Good Pitch was helpful. So we had a lot of support, and unlike our previous films, we had to bring in like lots of partners to make it. Wordplay was completely self-financed. We sold it at Sundance for $1 million. It was profitable for us. It was great. IOUSA, we had a publishing company that had done a book on the topic that mm-hmm. came to us and helped with the funding. So every one is different. Every one of these films is different. Really.
So is either one of you or your wife, more of the funding person, or more one of the more?
Well, Christine is a producer. Christine mm-hmm. is the producer, so that's certainly more of her expertise. I'm a cameraman and a director, and I really am out there with the story and mm-hmm. working with our editors and the rest of our team, our graphic designer and everyone else. We have a really great partnership in that sense. And I would say Christine's job on this last film was much harder because, like I said, If You Build It was, I think people didn't realize it was going to be really special until it was done. Mm. So once it was done, we ended up getting a lot of support for the film and are still getting a lot of support. We just won an Independent Spirit Award last week. We won the Bright Future Award, which was presented by Unilever Project Sunlight. That was a mm-hmm. big deal for us. That victory or that award and that grant that we won is going to help us continue to roll out the film even more. I think what's happening is people are recognizing that documentary films can be very powerful. Mm. They live on for a very long time. A lot of people see them. They create real impact in people's lives. I mean, not every film. Like, Wordplay right. is not going to change anyone's life. If You Build It is about, the story is really about the fact that a great education can happen anywhere. Mm. And here's how. That's a pretty powerful story. I mean, there's a lot of people who want to see that story and help make their local school a better place for their kids. That has universal appeal. We're taking the film to China. We have a, there's a program called Film Forward that Sundance and the White House have created. So we're going to be in China later on this spring. We're going to be in Taiwan. Christine is going to Philadelphia through that program. So, I mean, it's, I think people, organizations, businesses, et cetera, they see that if there's a really good story with a really good, that could create real positive impact in people's lives, they want to get, they want to help get that out there. You know, it's
so
it's
do you been, have a mindset going into, I mean, you obviously made the movie, you get to the end of it, is it, you know, we need distribution, or maybe this one is going to be distributed differently, or
yeah, I mean, I think
open?
It's funny because we get asked occasionally, well, we get asked quite a bit, you know, I want to make a movie, I want to make a documentary, how do I do that? And we basically tell people that making the movie gets you to the 50-yard line. You're halfway there. Getting it out there gets you in the end zone. And if you make a movie and it ends up not being that great and you're not that proud of it, then distribution may ultimately not be quite as important for you. If you make a movie and you're really proud of it and you know it's really good and you've been with audiences who are cheering and laughing and crying and really moved by the film, you want to get it out there. You want to share that. So for us, more than anything, we look for stories that are interesting to us. Because if they're not, it's like they're too hard to make. I mean, if it's not interesting to right. you, it's going to be a long year or two of making a film. I don't know why people would ever want to do that. But once you find a story that's interesting to you, you go out and you try to make the best movie you can. Mm-hmm. And if you succeed in that and you're proud of the film and want to share it, then the distribution thing is a whole other mountain to climb. Yeah. We're working with Erin Owens at Longshot Factory. She used to be at Think Film for a long time. Mm-hmm. She's absolutely fantastic. And she's built a wonderful team of theatrical relation folks and publicists, social media folks. She's put together a really kind of an all-star team, which is great. She doesn't have to have a 20-person team to release movies.
Right.
She can have a very small team and bring in the right experts per project.
So it's an interesting time because somebody like Gabriella, I want to say Cooper, but it's not Cooper, but Gabriella, who made Blackfish,
yeah,
you know, had a very successful theatrical compared to the way theatricals are these days, and yet she also Copperthwaite.
Yes,
there you go. But she was really happier in some ways, I think, by the CNN exposure, because even though there wasn't necessarily that much money in it, there were a lot more people, you know, there were 2 million people or whatever saw the movie on CNN.
Right.
When it ran 4 times or 8 times or whatever
right.
it ran. So there was like this, and then there were people who were putting stuff on, you know, YouTube and just giving it away for free because they want more people to see it. And it's, all those choices are evolving in an interesting way.
Yeah, you know, it's, I think every filmmaker, it's, you know, maybe it's because we have 3 kids and we're a married couple, but our movies sort of feel like our kids in a way. Like each one of them is like, you're like a parent to the film, if you want to go down that metaphor road. And every parent wants different things for their kids.
Mm-hmm.
And with our films, I can say that for me, the best thing we could achieve is that audiences get to see it in a theater. Because the screenings we've had have been absolutely incredible. At the same time, like Wordplay ran on independent lens and like a million people saw the movie that night. And that's awesome too, because that there's much broader reach through television and other, you know, Netflix and things like that. You don't always have the same impact. You don't get as much wood on the ball, so to speak, to use a baseball metaphor, as you might in a theater. So it's, at the end of the day, I mean, you hope that the movie that you've made is something you're proud of. And you hope that audiences connect with it and that it really makes an impression on them. And however they see it is how they're going to see it. But for me personally, nothing is better than being in a packed theater and the lights go down and you can hear a pin drop and your movie starts. Maybe I'm just really old-fashioned, but that's my favorite way to see a movie, and it's definitely my favorite way to share a movie that we've made.
And your kids are now getting to be old enough to not only see your movies, but critique them, probably.
But critique them, yeah. My kids like to critique our movies. I mean, our office is in our guest house. It's behind our house in Los Feliz, which is a neighborhood here in L.A. They're around all the time. I think they enjoy it. You know, I think they enjoy the fact that we're home most of the time, working. Mm-hmm. One of my daughters was really insistent on a title for our film. She wanted a different title than we ended up using, and she's 7, and she's very opinionated. So that was a long talk. I think we had to go get ice cream and talk that out. But I like it. You know, I do like that I can have a family. My wife and I can have a family and also make movies at the same time. I think we're very lucky that we get to do that, because that doesn't always work out sometimes. Mm-hmm. Oftentimes with filmmaking, there's quite a bit of traveling for some folks. And I certainly travel sometimes, as does my wife, but we make our movies at home. And you know, this last movie took about 2 years to make. We were at home every day cutting our film. So it's nice. I like it, and I like our setup.